every cat functioning.
It's not looking at the way you are looking at that thing. That's the way, that is the natural state, not enlightenment, not transformation, nothing of that kind. I am saying this is functioning in a very natural way. That's why I am describing the sensory activity of the human body. Nothing else is there. Even this sensory activity is something which cannot be experienced. I am telling you that this is the way it is operating, because you think that there is some continuity there. For your sake, I am experiencing this thing using the knowledge you and I have to tell you that this is not the way it is functioning. The eye is not looking at the things the way you are looking at. So, if that knowledge you and I have about that one is absent, you don't look at all. There is no looking there. So it is not that I look at that in a different way, different from the way you are looking at. So when I am using the knowledge which I have, like anybody else, you and I are looking at the things in exactly the same way. So when that is not in operation there, there is no way you can look at anything, because there is no way you can separate yourself from that and look at it. What am I burns itself out. Then there won't be any questions of any kind at all.
There is some other question.
No other question. All questions are the same.
All questions. Any kind.
Any kind.
So we have to stop there.
No.
To be silent, don't speak about things. Why we are there meeting?
Yeah.
Why?
You are the one to ask that question.
Why? Answer me.
Because please. You want to know.
Eh?
You want to know.
I want to know.
Yeah, more and more. And through this, that will maintain its continuity. That's all. You are not even listening to me. Art of listening, forget it. There is no art of listening, there is no art of seeing. Just forget that. It's a romantic stuff. The art of listening. That listener is interested in listening. And through this listening, that listener continues. I dyed them. I dyed them today, the colors.
Also.
If you are not here, I do some such.
At least you do something useful.
Useful. This is also an obsession, you know, matching colors.
That's fine.
You see, there is no way you can free yourself from your conditioning, no matter who says what.
So, you also are conditioned.
I am not trying to uncondition myself. Why are you bothered about it? Why do you want to uncondition yourself? Because some joker sits on a platform and takes you on a journey and tells you that you are going to have an unconditioned mind. That itself is conditioning you. You don't understand that. The very demand to uncondition your conditioned mind is conditioning it.
So there's no such thing as an unconditioned mind?
Not at all. And then you cannot describe that as love, bliss, beatitude, immensity.
There is nothing to transform, nothing to achieve, nothing to be.
And yet
it is the guru of the nothing.
No, oh boy, oh boy, boy, oh boy. And if that is what you think, is what I am saying. Why do you keep coming day after day, day after day? Apart from the fact that we both are friends, we both went to the same school, products of the same background, Theosophy, Krishnamurti, etc., etc. You had Catholic background, I had Hindu background. Basically,
the only difference.
No, that's also the same.
This is also
exactly
the same. To be Catholic or a Hindu. Hinduist is all
just
complete. U.G. Krishnamurti is India's most enigmatic thinker. Categorizing him is virtually impossible. He has no claims to enlightenment, makes no promises of salvation, offers no solutions to man's mounting problems. In fact, he light-heartedly scorns at all the accepted norms, traditions, and conventions. He ruthlessly lobs cynical grenades at each and every citadel of authority and belief born out of centuries of human wisdom. UG endlessly repeats, "I have no message to mankind." He discourages people from coming to see him. Yet, thousands of people the world over flock to listen to UG's unique brand of discourse. But you know, he doesn't make things easy for them. UG organizes no gatherings, gives no lectures, offers no courses, has no organization, no centers, no office, no secretary. Like his growing legend, UG is everywhere and nowhere. He has no worldly belongings other than what he fits into a small suitcase. He has no fixed abode and has been traveling ever since he was 14. At 76, UG is going round the world twice every year and continues to remain vigorously enigmatic. At one stage of his life, during the course of his ceaseless quest for enlightenment, UG was a sort of a drifter. He ended up at the Indian consulate, Geneva, totally broke and penniless and ready to be deported to India. There he met Madame Valentine Dokerwan, a 63-year-old Swiss lady. She was working as a translator in the Indian consulate. Soon, they both became close friends. She said, "If you don't want to go to India, don't go. I can arrange for you to stay in Switzerland." Then she created a home for him in Sanen. Later on, they moved to Gstaad. Eventually, she gave up her job with the Indian consulate. Since that chance meeting 30 years ago, UG's and Valentine's lives melded. They remained, as UG puts it, fellow travelers with no destination till the sunset of her life. Valentine created the fund for the travels of UG Krishnamurti from her inheritance. But after her death in 1991, UG gave away the funds to an Indian family who looked after her in her last days. One day in Sanen, UG was sitting on a bench under the cool shade of a wild chestnut tree. The beautiful spot overlooks one of the most enchanting views of the seven hills and the seven valleys of the Sanen overland. The burning question, which by then had been gathering momentum, was raging inside of UG. How the hell do I know that I am in the same state of Buddha, Jesus, Shankara, and all those masters of the mankind? The question gripped his entire being. Then all of a sudden, the question disappeared. It was like a nuclear explosion, shattering every cell, every nerve, every gland in his body. That was the beginning of what he calls the calamity, an utterly non-religious biological mutation resulting in several irreversible biological changes in his body. That was his 49th birthday. The changes in his body continued for 7 days. Note the changes in his appearance before and after the calamity. On the 7th day of his calamity, UG died physically. What brought him back to life? What indeed is this man called UG? How does he live? How does he function? How is he affected by his natural state, which he describes as his state of being?
And the three fourths and full moon and then also the other half. So I cannot say how I am affected. They don't in any way influence my actions. You know, sometimes I feel dull and stupid.
But they do influence your energy level.
Energy level is...
That's the only influence.
That's the only thing.
So when is your battery the fullest? When is your energy... I mean, when you look at the...
That's very strange when there is nobody around me. I just lie down there. I am dead most of the time. You see, there is no... what is the word? I don't even have the word. The impetus even to come out of my bed
or fix something and eat something. Sometimes if I am all alone, with nobody is around me, I don't even eat for 2 days, three days.
You don't. But what about the body? The body needs its energy.
It seems to thrive on its own energy, But I do come out because it's foolish to lie down there, and the body does need some energy.
Yeah.
So what is the point in... this is not something like samadhis or all those holy men talked about. It has nothing to do with it.
But when the
activity of the sensory the sensory activity slows down.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it is very necessary for the body to renew itself.
Mm-hmm.
Why it has to slow down is because the senses are acting all the time at their peak capacity. Because nothing is interfering with the activity of the sensory organs. So they are at their peak capacity. So naturally they have to slow down.
And recharge.
And renew themselves. So that is the process that is going on, I think. I cannot make any definite statements about this, but you see, my eyes may be open. It's like a curtain falling, you see. I don't see anything, you know.
The eyes might be open, but
I see nothing, I hear nothing, I smell nothing, you see, it's sitting here like a curtain falling, you know, just for a fraction of a second. And you know, sometimes if there is a demand, if I'm surrounded by some people and something is demanded of me or from me, it doesn't bother me.
No.
No, not at all. No. It depends upon the situation I find myself in.
So when there's no people around, this organism slows down and nothing actually happens. You could sit here with your eyes open or lie on bed, in bed.
Yes.
And would you be aware of yourself sitting there or lying there?
No.
No way.
No way.
No way you can know.
Nothing is there. Nothing is there between the sheets. Nothing is there. So that's the reason why I'm questioning the very idea or the concept of consciousness. There is no such thing as consciousness at all. To say the stimulus and the response is one unitary movement.
And there's no translating there.
No translating at any time except when there is a need or a demand. And only one way. That is why the relationship with me is very difficult for anybody, because it's one way, their needs, but I have no needs for them. I was telling him this morning that your psychological problems don't touch me at all, you know. Your sorrow you are talking about is, to use a metaphysical phrase, your psychological pain, psychological feelings, they never touch me. Only the physical pain, if there is any, the physical suffering there is any, that's the one that will affect.
But not the psychological.
Nothing.
So if someone comes here who is very depressed and feels very sorry,
it doesn't touch me at all.
I mean, he could cry and stand on his head, but it wouldn't affect you.
That's why I tell them, you see, that, your tears don't impress me at all.
Specifics of the calamity. Specifics of the calamity.
No.
About all the, what happened. Why not?
Because there is a danger of simulating those things, as I said a while ago. It is neither psychological nor physiological transformation. And at that time when all these Krishnamurti freaks threw those phrases at me, ad nauseam, all those empty words and empty phrases, I had to emphasize, overemphasize that it is not the psychological thing at all. So whatever happened resulted in these physical problems, you see, the physical changes because of the realignment of the body. And so that description makes people to simulate those things and feel that they are going through that kind of a thing. So since there is nothing there to be transformed, nothing there to be changed, it really doesn't matter whether you call it a psychological transformation or a physiological transformation. What I am saying is there is nothing there to be transformed, period, full stop. Yes, I have some goodies hidden somewhere.
It's open.
You can take everything.
Because there is
whatever
nothing.
Whatever I have, there is
nothing. Because there is nothing.
Now, even if there is something there, you can take it. You don't have to pay anything. You can take it. Anybody can
but
take Uji, anything they want.
Uji, when I take tomorrow a gun with me, and I point it at the...
At me?
At the head of your
I'll bring a machine gun and shoot you.
Oh,
I'm not so sure.
No, no, Salim. Right.
I'm not a non-violent man.
What's there afterwards?
Afterwards?
What's there afterwards?
You, I wouldn't be there to tell you anything afterwards, you see.
The chalet sunbeam, the interior of Yuji's house. View from his window, which he hardly opens.
I would like to record all the funny story about JK. To have a recorder and to let you...
I have forgotten the...
Yes, but really try. Only the joke.
En français.
Or in Italian, as you like. But because I think this will be the most interesting...
How many years have you been with the
27. I begin in
1927.
61
years.
61 years with
the
old man.
Yes.
Wow. He belongs to the very...
61-year-old. 60-year-old club.
Yes, I was in the order of this time. But I was in the Theosophical Society till 32. We were at this time, there was only Raja Gopal. Raja Gopal and Krishna Ji, they came here home and some friends, four, no more. We takes a chamber in a big hotel, always first kind of hotel, because Krishna Ji lives in a very expensive simplicity.
he takes the
chamber and the salotto, come si dice salotto, non so.
Living room.
Living room there. And so we meet four, five, and we have some discussion like that. But at this time he was younger than me, of course. And in the afternoon and in the evening we go out to take some, come si dice, cena.
Dinner
in Roman Trattoria. Or to work in a Villa Borghese. And I remember that one time we were in one Roman Trattoria and in the next table two people take pasta asciutta. It was a very mountain of pasta asciutta. And he saw, very surprised, but how can they think after that? And we say, but they have not the problem to think.
They have not, you know?
We have not the problem to, they have not the problem to think. The official, come si dice, conferenziere, io promote me as a... Ho capito.
That's more interesting than what I have to say. Everybody is laughing.
Ah, sorry.
When I talk, they're...
No, just walking. Walking between here and Sodom.
Oh, I got like in the train.
He was in the inner circle, wasn't he?
The one who has translated the mistake in French and translating the second book.
Who is? Oh, really?
She's from Paris.
Yeah.
Really good.
So what have you got? Listen, so tell me, what have you got to say today about the human situation?
You don't even know where
because
you are.
Because look, I was born in ignorance.
No, that you... don't repeat all that.
Well, how can you not say that? Because this is my condition, this is what I feel.
You are saying so many things which are not true. How in your case.
How can you speak?
You are making assertions.
I come to see you, right? I feel...
You have come to the wrong man.
I've come to see you. I say to you, please, I'm ignorant. Advise me on how I go from the darkness into the light. That's all I'm asking.
First of all, you have come to the wrong man.
Well, that's a cop-out.
Not a cop-out.
He has forgotten it. So if you say you've got some kind of knowledge, that's the knowledge that I want to hear. Simply because I feel that that knowledge can liberate me from ignorance.
I tell you that the knowledge is the one that is responsible for your ignorance.
Right.
And that knowledge cannot be any help to you to free yourself or liberate yourself from this. So you want to know more and more and more and more. It's not going to lead you anywhere. If there is somebody in this world who will help you to free yourself from ignorance, you are most welcome. I don't even want to say good luck to you. Every individual in this world is that you want to be happy without even one moment of happiness. That is just not possible. You have to take my word. If you don't want to take my word, it is just fine with me. I do not know what happiness is like, so I can never be unhappy. Of yourself, that you are ignorant, that you are a wise man, that you know all-knowing, that you are all-seeing and all that kind of guff, you see? But you have actually no way of separating yourself and looking at yourself and tell yourself that this is me. What are you and who are you? Who
well,
are
that's you? What I don't
who
know.
Are you is
that's
wrong.
What I don't know.
No, no, listen.
I don't know that. That's why I'm here.
No, who
because
are you?
I feel you know who you are.
I
feel you know who you are. I feel that I don't know who I am. I see you as a bridge between ignorance and some kind of mystical, esoteric, secret knowledge that will reveal to me who innermost I am.
Frankly tell you that I don't have any mystical, esoteric, what other words?
Secret knowledge.
No. Sorry, I don't have any such thing. I don't know anything about those things. What all I know is what I have been taught and memorized. So I am nothing but a memory.
Mechanical. Not organic, no.
Yeah. Organic also is mechanical.
The question, who am I? And if you put some time, what was your answer?
Who am I?
You.
You want the answer?
You don't put really, this question.
No, I never asked.
Your answer was, I really don't know. But you are.
It is a foolish question to ask.
Why?
It's because I have no way of telling myself this is me.
You know,
I don't have an image of myself. Only that image is created by your thoughts, feelings and experiences. You create an image. And in relationship with that image, you try to establish relationships. You see? So, I don't have any way of telling myself, this is me. What are you? You tell me, what are you? If I throw this question at you, who are you? First of all, this idiotic question arises because you think that there is something more than what you know who you are. Otherwise, you wouldn't ask that question.
Something more
than. First of all, tell me what you are. who you are. I don't know which is the correct...
I have no answer.
No answer? Then why you are breaking your head to find out who you are? Some idiot, you see some Swami there, some Ramana Maharshi, threw that question at everybody. Who are you? Find out. And that starts the whole business. You see, the assumption that there is something there, you have to know. That there is another I, other than the I you know of.
But are you saying then there's no assumption there within you?
No.
The question's there.
The question is not there for me. See, I'm wondering why you ask all these questions.
Yeah, what's the question?
I'm only pointing out and emphasizing that all your questions arise from the assumptions. That's all. You have the answers. So this is too silly to sit here and indulge in this question and answer stuff.
But you're saying questions.
Simple questions I have. Basic questions I have to ask to survive in this world. Really, I don't ask any questions. You all have answers. It is too silly to sit and discuss. You are asking questions for which you already have answers. You don't seem to realize that. If you don't have an answer, there is no question. You keep asking the question, 61 years, 48 years, 100 years. Why you are asking the same question?
Because the answers don't work.
The answers don't work. Why don't you throw the answer out? You are that answer. You see, there is nothing there other than the answer. That answer is given by some joker, you see. So the sentiment comes into the picture. If you throw the answer, you are throwing the man out, in whom you have tremendous faith and consider him to be the wisest man that this world has ever produced. He claims that, and you accept that claim. The sentimentality comes into the picture, and you don't want to throw him out. And you have no way of throwing him out. It is an idiotic question to ask, who am I? So the man who throws that question is out.
A liter of cream, eh? And a small glass of orange juice. Let's say that's my breakfast. Day after day, year after year until I go. And do you think it is enough for your nutrition? I have survived 70 years. Rice flakes. No, the flakes.
No, this is oatmeal. Oatmeal.
In America they call it. No. Beginning, I need a coffee.
Which thing?
This is how you cover it.
31?
What do you call it? What do you call it? Cream, eh?
What cream
builds in your body? For bone fat, don't believe all that crap. Just bone fat.
And they leave it out, man.
There isn't a damn thing that you can do to change the situation. Sorry.
Herman, are you going to have a coffee?
Yes.
Excuse me.
Right to the middle. 17th century. a book called Galateo.
Yes.
About all, it was all about good manners, you know, how you should behave to be a proper courtesan. Have you been raised that way?
I grew up in that atmosphere, but I never observed any of those things because I felt, and even now I feel, all table manners are obscene.
Obscene?
I go one step further and say eating at a table is obscene.
Where
haven't you seen me eating, walking, you know, running sometimes? The people are so loyal to the monarchy. Like that, you see, the language is a very obsessive factor in France. They think too much of their language, you know. And unfortunately, it was used for decades, probably for a couple of centuries, I don't know, as a diplomatic language.
Why, unfortunately?
I mean, what is it so very,
it's a very beautiful language.
I don't know, since I don't know French, you see.
You know,
you can
well.
Get away with that kind of thing. Yeah. It has not produced any outstanding writers, not many.
Balzac, Victor Hugo.
One or two, you see. So how many writers you
have? Maupassant, Zola.
You can count them on your fingers, you see, you know. Maybe it has produced some good literature, otherwise, and a hopeless philosopher, Descartes, you see, who was considered to be the father of modern philosophy.
Now, right, he, going back to the thought with bourgeois, Descartes is the very first who says, I think, therefore I am.
If you don't think, what the hell you are, he never asked that question. The so, Indian philosophers did at any rate. Not that they were any the better, they also created a tremendous metaphysics there. And here you have created a tremendous structure of philosophical thought. That's the only difference. That's why the Joker was called the father of modern philosophy. France has not produced many philosophers.
The whole Western thinking is born of that
assumption
that your ego, your existence, everybody has his own existence because he has his own thought.
Not his own. He claims, unfortunately, that it is his own thought. You don't have any thought which you can call your own. I don't have anything which I can call my own.
Usually we identify with our thoughts. That's why
you have, you see, appropriated them to yourselves and say that these are my thoughts. No, they will, you see, you
so it is arbitrary.
You know, you use that thought to achieve, you see, a particular goal. I use the same thought to achieve another goal, you see. But the goal may be different, but the instrument which I am using to achieve my goals is the same. There is nothing there, first of all, to empty. No matter who says what, Pavlov, you will never be without thoughts. Never. You know? In the sleep, they are suppressed into the subterranean regions because the body demands to rest, you see, so that it can renew itself. That's all it is interested in. That is why you dream. You know?
Yeah, so, I mean, this constant inner dialogue that goes on day by thinking about projects or naming and labeling and everything, and night...
The past or the future?
The past, the future, and in night you go on by dreaming?
Yes, that's right.
Yeah. But this process seems to have ceased in you.
That does not mean the thoughts are not there. I don't use them to achieve any goal, spiritual or material. The becoming is the problem. You want to become something that you are not. There, all this energy is wasted. It consumes so much of energy. So that doesn't leave energy to solve the simple day-to-day problems. All that is wasted there. If you are at peace with yourself, assuming for a moment that you are at peace with yourself, you become the enemy of the other.
Say it again.
If you are at peace with yourself, such an individual becomes the enemy of the society. Because that's not the peace that they are interested in.
A peaceful man is a threat. Sure.
Peaceful?
No. If, as you say, you are the only peaceful one, you are a threat to him. You are a threat to the way.